What's happening, guys? Welcome back. If you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe so you can catch spills every week. And don't forget to hit that bell up top so we can squad up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so the Infinity War Prelude Part 2 is here. And I swear, Marvel is just dangling what little information that they can, like, in our faces. Shamelessly, and it's crazy. Because this issue sets out to tell us where all the Infinity Stones are right now. And I like what it does as far as starting with post-Doctor Strange and kind of weaving through Thor Ragnarok. And for anybody who's new here, all these Prelude comics are canon for the films. So anytime you pick up one of these and you read the dialogue, it's verbatim from the movie. And the same is to be taken from everything that we're shown that's happening in between the films as well. So leading up to Infinity War or whichever respective film you're reading the Prelude to, everything in the issue will be canon to the film. And with that said, what we get pretty much in this Prelude is a conversation between Wong and Doctor Strange. And Wong pulls Doctor Strange from meditating in order to inform him of fear of what's to come. And as far as time frame, this is post-Doctor Strange once again and happening around the beginning of Thor Ragnarok. And if I had to guess, I'd say it's around the time Thor returned to Asgard and Matt Damon was given one of the greatest performances ever. But Wong tells Strange that even though he doesn't mean to pull him away from his studies, because it is critical that he continues to understand the multiverse and also better understand the mystic arts, because had he not before, the whole situation in China with Dormammu, it would have been a wrap. Had he not been ahead of the curve. But what's interesting is him recalling one of the last things we heard Mordo say at the end of Doctor Strange, warning the both of them that there will be consequences, that there will be a price to pay, and that there will be a reckoning. And in this prelude, we get to understand a bit more about what that meant. And I'm not gonna front, when I seen the film, and I just watched it again yesterday, or better yet, the day before yesterday. And I'll admit, when Mordo first said this in the film, I initially thought that he just meant that there will be consequences similar to the Ancient One. Like, if you keep breaking these laws of nature, eventually you'll have to pay for it. If you keep playing with that stone, you're gonna go blind, something crazy like that. Or at the most, foreshadowing him becoming the villain later on. But in this conversation between Wong and Doctor Strange, they revisit a similar conversation that they had at the end of the Doctor Strange film. And at that time, Wong informed Strange that the Eye of Agamotto had an Infinity Stone within it. And that was really the first time that Strange had heard an Infinity Stone, period. But fast forward to this conversation at this particular time, Wong informed Strange that there are more than just one Infinity Stone. And it's in this conversation that he tells him more specifically that within the Eye of Agamotto is the Time Stone. And Strange was partially aware to some of this because he knew it was an Infinity Stone because Wong told him before, and he knew it could manipulate time because of his studies in Kamar-Taj. But at this point, Wong was really informing him of where the other stones' history had been up until this point in the MCU. And as far as Wong is aware, he tells him where all the stones are except for two. And he doesn't do this to hold back any information from Strange. This is more of a situation of danger is coming, and he wants to share with him all the information he knows so Strange can be enlightened on what's coming ahead. And he does this by first giving them information about the Time Stone, which they have in their possession, and next he tells them about the Space Stone, which was in the Tesseract, and as far as he's aware, it's still in Asgard. And I'm pretty sure once we get to the point of the Infinity War film, just kinda going by the trailer and just filling in the gaps here, I'm pretty sure towards the end of this conversation is when Banner comes through the roof, possibly by way of the Space Stone, or better yet, the Tesseract, because it's still in the Tesseract at this point. But Banner either got his hands on it and was sent to Earth, very similar to the Red Skull and Captain America the First Avenger when he got his hands on the Tesseract and was sent to God knows where. Because with the Space Stone, if you're able to wield it, you can think of a place and just go there. And of course, Banner and everyone else leaving Asgard was on their way to Earth. Red Skull, on the other hand, I guess he just drew a blank and he had like a brain fart when he held it. Which is really the worst time to draw a blank when you're holding a relic that can take you wherever you're thinking. Think fast, think faster. But he ain't think fast enough. We ain't know where he at. He probably gonna be in the post credit. Talking about, I've been falling for 7 years. That would be crazy. Yeah, that Tesseract ain't nothing to play with. But at this point in the prelude, Wong believes the Tesseract is still in Asgard. The trailer is really what gives us the extra hint to how him and Strange get more information about that. But as far as the Aether, which is the Power Stone, Wong informs Strange about the events that took place during Thor: The Dark World, which ultimately conclude with the Power Stone being in the hands of the Collector still. And that's probably the most brief description because when you think about it, the Power Stone didn't really move around as much as others like the Space Stone or the Mind Stone. And the Mind Stone is the one he informs him about next. But the Aether, unlike many of the others, it hasn't really moved around a whole lot. And from what we're told here, it's still in the possession of the Collector. And so it's really here that Strange really gets the notion that, okay, when Asgardians come to Earth, there's trouble. Okay, got it. because now that he knows more details about the event that happened in New York, and he gets a bit more insight about Loki's involvement in the invasion, but even going back further than that to Captain America the First Avenger, and him now knowing that the Tesseract, which threw the war in the favor of Red Skull and Hydra, that before it was here on Earth, it was in Odin's vault. And on top of that, ending the event in New York, you got Loki's scepter. So in Strange's eyes, while Wong is telling him all this, Asgard is like 3 for 3 for Infinity Stone trouble. But as far as the scepter, we all know in that one, you got the Mind Stone. It created the Enhanced, Stark used it to create Ultron, and as a result of the Age of Ultron, we got the birth of Vision. And as far as the Mind Stone, Wong really leaves it there, because as far as anybody on Earth, they believe for Vision to be the safest place for it to be. One, because he's proven himself trustworthy, pun intended, but Vision's also trusted with it pretty much because nobody really believes anyone's gonna take it from him. Yeah, let's see how that goes. But this brings us over to the Power Stone. And from here, Wong informs Strange about Celestials in what I would imagine to be pretty much the same story we got from the Collector in Guardians of the Galaxy, Volume 1. But what's interesting enough at this point, we find out that Wong really doesn't know what happened to the Power Stone and what we saw take place in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1. And I'm not even 100% sure that he knew it was on the planet Morak, because when he mentions it to Strange, he just says that it's amongst the stars. But us as viewers, we know that it's made its way to Xandar with the Nova Corps after the events taking place in the first Guardians of the Galaxy film. And it's a strong possibility this is the second place that Thanos goes to, after first using the Tesseract to get there, wiping out pretty much everybody who gets in his way, collecting the Power Stone, placing it on the gauntlet first, and then possibly using that Power Stone to separate the Space Stone from the Tesseract, so then he can place the Space Stone on the gauntlet as well. But when Wong tells Strange this, he stops at 5, and I'm just looking at the page like, how convenient, you stop right at the Soul Stone. But what we find out is the reason that he stopped is that Thor and Loki had just arrived on Earth, and this gives us that scene straight out of Thor Ragnarok. And with the way it's delivered in the prelude, we're given a bit more behind the motivation of Doctor Strange pulling Thor and Loki so quick as soon as they arrive to Earth. Because for Strange, it's fresh on his mind that Asgardians on Earth is not a good thing, and this is why Doctor Strange was so quick to help them find Odin so they can get their daddy and keep it pushing. But more on that scene, it's all in the film. After that, the prelude skips over to the continuation of the conversation between Wong and Strange. And I don't know about you guys, but me personally, I'm just like, okay, about that Soul Stone, where were we? Like rubbing my hands together and everything. But when Wong gets to the Soul Stone, he's like, little is known about the Sixth Stone. It could prove to be the biggest threat of them all. And I'm just like, what? You made me wait for that? Come on, man. Like, I don't think y'all understand. Like, I was really feeling some type of way. But I did notice something, and I'm really eager to hear what you guys think after this. But in this book, every time that he would speak of a different stone, the picture in the book would give some type of hint to the origin of that particular stone. And when I say origin, I mean more so the origin of man's knowledge of that stone. And from the three planets that we see in the picture, they look pretty similar to Jupiter, Saturn, and Uranus. In the order of the three, without showing the specific lines that show the revolution of the planet around our sun, without those guidelines, the order can kind of seem a little different. And if you don't have those lines to either show you or tell you which one's further than the next, to the naked eye, you would believe that this is the true scale and size and order of each planet. Because you're literally staring into space, there's nothing in the background to scale and say, well, this is bigger than that, or this is closer than that. Except, we all know, or most people know, that Saturn is a little bit larger than Uranus. Better yet, a lot larger. But when something is larger and is further away, it can appear to be a lot smaller or the same size as an object that is closer from your vantage point. And keep in mind, like I said, the order between these two, it can vary depending on where you're at in space. In whatever position you move to in space, those planets will appear to seem in that order. And that's not because Saturn moves further from the sun, it's just because you're in a different spot. And last but not least, I know somebody gonna be like, well, doesn't Uranus have rings? Which is a good point, but even in history and even current day, there's certain maps that draw Uranus without rings and still have the other planets with rings. And that's mainly because the rings are so thin. And last but not least, you got Jupiter's texture, which is spot on, and the eye is even in the same space, like lower down. But I'ma leave that alone. I said all that to say this, that it is possible, just possible, that the Soul Stone entered our solar system at this place by means of some type of item that allows other things to travel through space. And that really just goes back to my theory earlier of one stone interacting with another, because the stones all want to be together, and whoever hid the Soul Stone a long time ago, or perhaps sometime in the future, possibly used one stone to hide the next, or possibly a combination of stones to choose when this stone would arrive in our solar system. So with that being said, I still believe the Soul Stones in Wakanda. So there. Baba, will you tell us a story about the beginning? There it is. But that'll do it for this one, guys. Let me know if you've been checking out the Prelude comics, what you think about them. Let me know in the comments below. Smash that like button if you enjoyed the video. And I got links up for other Infinity War talk, so check those out, and we'll do it again on the next one. All right, later.